I look at Marceline, and I think she knows how to take the hair off a moose hide and soften it and ply it into supple, tough moccasins to last a man 2 years. And in the big cities, there are thousands of big and little kids who dream of learning how to do these things, of living close to the land, getting away from the pavement and the broadloom and the colored stoves and toilets they grew up on, and making it on their own, on the land. But Marceline and her Métis family and neighbors never chose to live this way. They had no choice. Not welcome in the towns. Jobs scarce for a Métis man. This life is normal for Marceline. It's not bad, she says. She makes her moccasins and beadwork, sometimes a coat. Babysits the grandchildren while the young people go away to work. And if they move into town, into this new project people are talking about, Marceline thinks that would be better. A warmer house, a little more room for people, water in the taps, electric light, and a furnace. That would be okay. And the moose hides? Oh yeah, she'll still be able to do that, out back maybe. Or maybe in the basement, by the furnace.
Chased a rainbow through the fields to the smell of a summer rain. And I've caught the sunlight in my hands through a broken window pane. I've felt the cold breath of December through my frosted hair. And heard willows snap their fingers to the echoes in the air.
I visit the families of Moccasin Flats, and I hear in my mind the voices of the white townspeople across the ridge, who tell me the Métis are lazy and dirty and drunken and useless. I sit in the midst of this gentle hospitality, I drink the tea, I listen to the soft, slow, husky melody of a tongue that's native to this land, unlike my own. And I wonder how the voices of Moccasin Flats and the voices of the town across the ridge will get along together, if one will have to yield to the other. Will the smoky sounds of Cree still murmur on the wide paved street, under the electric light, among the plumbing and the thermostats, and all the other penetrations of the white man's world? Thank you. But maybe that's all sentiment. I can leave Moccasin Flats when I choose. Leave with an airplane ticket to a house with a furnace, and a toilet, and plug-ins for my car in the winter, and a Cascade 40 full of comfort for my chilled bones. But a small blonde person, learning now to beat out rhythms from the forest-dwelling times, still has to grow up knowing how to make it in the white man's world. And if the small blonde person is labeled Indian, or native person, or half-breed, and that label also reads, made in Moccasin Flats, then making it in town can be tough. And living on a curved street, close to the school, in houses just like everybody else, might overcome a lot of prejudice, maybe do a lot to give a small blonde person, or a small dark person, a firmer sense of belonging to the world of possibilities. Possibilities just here is the town of Chetwynd. Prosperous enough for an overgrown valley village. Lumber keeps it going, mainly. It's prosperous enough to have a couple of good hotels and a brand new hospital with all the trimmings. Chetwynd men, if they're not in the lumber, will be away on construction work somewhere in the province. A number of them, including some of the non-status Indians from Moccasin Flats, climb in their cars every morning and head up the valley to a huge power project that has transformed miles of that valley into a big lake and keeps some money flowing in the area. Chetwynd is healthy enough to have an expansionist outlook. And to one town official, the mayor in fact, expansion ought to include the people of Moccasin Flats. What did they think? What the mayor was interested in was more people within his town limits. More on the tax rolls, more per capita grant from the province, a $1,000 per family homeowner grant from Victoria, money to stay in Chetwynd and help it prosper even more, and the closing down of an unsightly slum on his outskirts. The men listened. They wanted to make sure it was good for them, not just good for the town. And what grew out of a whole series of encounters like this one, in the basement of the Chetwynd Motel, patiently working through some residues of mutual suspicion, patiently working through the conception and carrying and birth of an important idea, was this. The Métis people, the people of Moccasin Flats, would form a corporation, the Chetwynd Housing Cooperative, a legally incorporated non-profit corporation to build houses. The town would put up the land at $1 a lot. Central Mortgage and Housing would put up low-cost, long-term mortgages, plans, and lots of advice. The people of Moccasin Flats would do most of the work. It seemed, when all the costs were called, like an idea whose time had come.
I'm gonna build me a dream. Gonna build it with my heart. There's a voice deep inside me saying, make a brand new start. Make a brand new start. I see a new day coming, and it's coming very fast. And I wondered if I want this, for I'm haunted by the past. Yes, I'm haunted by the past.
The thing was, it would be their corporation. Sure, and if they wanted to go into the high-rise business too, or build stores or factories, why not? What was to stop them? Of course. course, some of the people of Chetwynd, maybe even some who mingled with the Moccasin Flats folk decently enough around a public bonfire, because after all it was Christmas, predicted disaster. The Indians couldn't pull it off, they said. They'd start it, but they couldn't finish it. Wait and see. There were, let it be said, a lot of people in Chetwynd who only barely bought the mayor's financial arguments, who really didn't want to see the town discolored, who'd just as soon see Moccasin Flats and all its inhabitants disappear into the forests from whence they presumably came so long ago.
Shadow in your eyes, you can't ever really hide. You bought yourself a ticket for a train you'll never ride. You covered up your ears so you can't see, well that's just fine. Giving is a pleasure when your feeling isn't signed upon the line.
But for now, they'd be quiet. And so for now with the people of Moccasin Flats, who had their plans to make and the business of life to carry on.
Sun shines forever, the clouds laugh today. And the winter that held you is melting away. The future is blooming with each passing day. And the feeling in your heart will show you the way. Yes, the feeling in your heart will show you the way. So dance, dance, dance to the music of your passing world. The dream in your eyes and the start of your life are now one.
But I've left something out. There's a house in Moccasin Flats where 14 people live in three small rooms, and it's not unique. This story is not just one of changing one area for another, moving to town from the country. These people pay $65 a month for these old boards. No insulation, only plastic windows in a subarctic winter. Their stove oil costs $25 a month. Firewood, another 25. Drinking water, brought out in a tank truck from town, another 25. A jeep from town to start your car, or tow it through the unplowed rutty tracks so the man can get to work, can run another $20-$30 in a real rough winter. And as if that's not bad enough, they're to be evicted. The owner wants the land back.
The dream in your eyes and the start of your life are now one.
Some of them own their own shacks, and maybe, if anyone else would let them use some land, they could put the shacks on skids and move them somewhere else for a while. But for most of Moccasin Flats, until the co-op came along, eviction simply meant going on the road.
Thank you.
The people of Moccasin Flats. Life has taken on a different flavor for them now. It may not be much changed on the surface, but underneath, there's a new current of purpose. It's the purpose that goes with knowing that you're making something for yourself, something to last, something to nourish the future, something to grow on. For 100 years, the white man's world has said to them, "You're no good. You don't belong. You can't make it." Now they're standing up and saying, "No, that's not true. Look what we're building here. And think again."
Yes, dance, dance, dance to the music of your passing world.
They've seized upon a possibility and made it real.
The eyes and the start of your life are now one. I see a new day coming, and it's coming very fast. And I wonder if I want this, for I'm haunted by the past. Yes, I wonder if I want this, for I'm haunted by the past.
But the journey across the ridge is not completed yet. The work moves ahead at the co-op, and the families wait to move in. And over the ridge, in the town, still there are people predicting disaster. Somehow, the gulf of history and language and race that divides two groups of people, whose wants and needs and basic attitudes are hardly distinguishable one from the other, persists beyond my understanding. I come into these houses, I hear the talk about the move. I hear a bit of anxiety here and there. Will they be able to make the payments? What if there's a bad year? What if someone should get sick? But mostly what I hear is a quiet confidence, an understanding that they're on to something good, a rich sense of community, of membership in a group that's doing something special, something noteworthy, something the world is going to pay attention to. But as the cards go round, I still wonder about the values that they'll leave behind. Still wonder if their earth and water roots can take hold on the pavement. Is that just my white prejudice at work? Or is the thought in some of their minds, dreaming about their past? And then I think, there really isn't time right now for all that speculation. Winter's on us once again. There are shacks without windows or water, drafty, crowded, and soon to be shut down anyway. The basic challenge has been a decent roof in a decent place, and a decent people has met that challenge, and now there's work to be done.
I'm gonna build me a dream, I'm gonna build it with my heart. There's a voice deep inside me saying, make a brand new start. Make a brand new start. I see a new day coming, and it's coming very fast. And I wondered if I want this, for I'm haunted by the past. Yes, I'm haunted by the past. There's love in my house to keep me satisfied. My dreams can't be shattered by the stormy times of life. Yes,
Yes, I see a new day coming. It's coming very fast. And I've wondered if I want this, for I'm haunted by the past. I'm building for my children, for I know it's gonna last. But I find myself looking through the window of the past. Through the window of the past. Yes, I see a new day coming, and it's coming very fast. And I wondered if I want this, for I'm haunted by the past. Yes, I'm haunted by the past.
Mortgage payments will cost about $120 a month. The estimated monthly hydro bill is $12 to $15. Gas for the furnace, another $20, $2 to $3 for water. And for many families, the total costs almost equal what they were paying back at the flats. There may be other costs, perhaps not in dollars. These are the people who'll know if it was worth it.